Hello everyone and welcome to today's Mondac webinar in association with Spiced Root Legal and an expert panel who will be discussing the life science industry in India and the associated risks and opportunities for you to be aware of. My name is Charlie Greenhead and I'm joined by a brilliant panel to take us through today's discussion. Praveen Raju, he leads Spiced Root Legal's market-leading healthcare, life sciences and wellness practice. He focuses on cross-border M&A transactions, public acquisitions, take privates, private equity investments, joint ventures, commercial partnerships, disposals, and corporate restructuring in this constantly evolving industry. Having spent a significant portion of his career at one of the world's largest law firms in Singapore, Praveen brings a unique ability to identify global trends in life sciences and how they may affect the domestic market. He has acted on some of the largest Indian and international M&A deals in this space. His clients include a wide range across the life sciences sector, including the likes of 3M, Dr. Reddy's Labs, Global Hospitals, Zenfold Ventures, String Bio, and Rahi Care. Matthew Chacko brings fairly unparalleled technology, data, and intellectual property nous to life sciences. His practice is centered around innovation in life sciences, health data, health tech, the use of artificial intelligence and medical devices, as well as the regulatory regime that surrounds these focus areas. Matthew's clients have included Bayer, Stryker, Tilomed, Lupin, Esco Life Sciences, Zulig Pharmaceuticals, Proximi, and Cure AI. Matthew is widely recognized as a leading lawyer by global legal directories, including the Legal 500. Now, before we begin today's webinar, a quick housekeeping item. You can submit questions to today's panel by typing them into the questions pane of the toolbar on the right-hand side of your page. The panel will endeavor to answer as many questions as possible during this Q&A session, but please do reach out to them after the webinar for additional information. It's now my pleasure to begin today's session. And the first question for our panel will be, how has India's role shifted in the global pharmaceutical industry following the COVID-19 pandemic?
Thanks. Firstly, thank you, Charlie. Thank you for having us on this panel. Delighted to be here and welcome everyone. So before I answer that question, I think Matthew can also jump in here if required. But we should go back a little bit in time to see how the pharma industry has evolved in India. So until the 1960s or the early mid-1970s, India was effectively a net importer of drugs. This changed sometime in 1970s with the introduction of the Indian Patents Act and the drug policy of 1978, which set the stage for Indian companies to establish themselves in the international markets. By the 1980s, India had transformed from being a net importer of drugs to a leading exporter for drugs. This was coupled with the 1991 liberalization of India. And if I recollect correctly, the 1984 Hatch-Waxman Act in the US, which boosted the production of generic medicines, which benefited Indian drug makers in many ways. So all of this together kind of ensured that India was one of the largest exporters towards the early 90s. So if we look at what India's pharmaceutical sector was pre-COVID to start with, India as a country was, and the Indian pharmaceutical industry was exporting close to around 20% or more of the generic medicines market and was one of the largest global generic medicines market manufacturers in the world. Domestically, the COVID pandemic did bring some issues to the forefront, which was also faced in other industries, but life sciences more because of the situation, which was shortage of manpower. There was domestic unavailability of medical inventory, lack of storage, logistic infrastructure, and also kind of highlighted the lack of R&D capabilities within India. But having said that, I think COVID-19 also underlined India's position as a supplier of essential and life-saving drugs to almost every part of the world. India's the industry's global contribution was amply evident in 2020 as the country led from the front in the supply of critical drugs and medicines to over 120 countries. Today, India is one of the largest low-cost vaccines to countries all over the globe. India's Serum Institute is regarded as the world's largest vaccine manufacturer by the number of production of doses and global sales. Add to that, the current geopolitical and the geoeconomic circumstances has also fostered a shift from drug production to higher awareness and innovation of drug equipment and vaccine manufacturing by pharmaceutical companies in India. While India is a prominent player in the vaccines and generics market, the next focus for India is research and development, and we see that happening in novel vaccines and drugs. We also see a slow shift back to bulk drugs. In the past, India had the capacity and the capability to manufacture many APIs locally. However, most were discontinued due to availability of low-cost imports. And these imports led to a gradual erosion of India's manufacturing capacity. But we can see that kind of reviving again. We also see a significant uptick, and if you look at the statistics, it also indicates that India already has a significant share of the global biosimilars market, and this segment is set to become the mainstream of Indian pharmaceutical industry. Additionally, I think, of course, we see an uptick in increased activity in R&D, clinical trials, and the medical devices space.
Yeah, so if I can add to that, what we've seen is kind of the next step in evolution of India's pharma industry. So if you look at it historically, we're well known for advanced pharmaceutical intermediary manufacturing. We're well known for some kind of outsourced clinical trials, not extensive. We're not well regarded. We're not historically a well-regarded market for, say, contract development and manufacturing. That has changed over the last 4 to 5 years, significantly post-COVID. We've seen a huge increase in contract development deals. We've seen a huge increase in small molecule manufacturing in India. So you can see a lot of Indian pharmaceuticals wanting to get into that space. And coupled with a all-round kind of focus on manufacturing in India, we've seen the pharma sector ramp up both on IP, and because of the ramp up on IP, we've seen them look at kind of now reaching out across the regulatory scheme across the globe to kind of figure out, hey, we've got this product, how are we, or we've got this molecule, how are we able to monetize that? All of these are going parallel with, say, advances in wellness companies. So we've seen a huge uptake in products like manufacture of vitamin K12. We've seen some kind of developments in peptides. We've seen all of these. We've seen investments flowing into India for all of these. And we've seen global markets open up for Indian products in those spaces. And thirdly, India's role as a kind of global center for hospitals and medical treatment as a tourism industry, we've seen an increase in that as well, with fairly large deals both in hospitals focused on international treatments as well as hospitals focused on domestic treatments. So the market, just to summarize, the market right now looks very, very different from what the market looked like, say, 10 years ago.
Okay, and our next question for the panel: are major pharma giants in India transitioning their focus from producing generic drugs to specific molecule products?
Right, absolutely. I think that this is driven by what is called the patent cliff, which is when products go off patent, and you know, the first cycle of this arose sometime between 2011 and 15, right? So there's a significant opportunity in the small molecule patented drug segment, opening up for the generics. And I think that that cycles, you know, probably again was the first cycle happened in 11, 15. I think the next cycle is also going to happen sometime in the latter part of this decade. And there are the likes, most players in the market with the exposure to the US market, like the likes of the Zydus, Torrent, Aurobindo, et cetera, are the ones who are expected to be the primary beneficiaries of this upcycle. And we see that there is a similar environment which is shaping up now as was there in that period, which was the first upcycle. And we anticipate a first competition suggestive of another patent cliff on the horizon. While India, with India having a very robust pipeline of generic drugs, this cliff should provide a tremendous growth opportunity for Indian pharmaceutical companies. We've also seen a lot of major Indian players having taken proactive steps by filing abbreviated new drug applications to seize these upcoming opportunities in the small molecule patent drug segment. In fact, I think that Indian companies, in fact, overtook the generics firms in the US to receive highest first-time ANDA approvals. So the generics market opening up for small molecule patented drugs will allow the Indian generic drug manufacturers to break barriers in previously unavailable avenues. The ability to file ANDAs in the sector should also provide a route for scaling up the drug product range of such Indian pharma companies. And also, this will naturally kind of increase global interest in such companies, opening up investment and strategic opportunities, as well as an upscaling in products will pave the way for more R&D investments to drive the sector forward. So absolutely, yes, Charlie, that is something that we see happening more often than not now.
And do you have anything to add to that, Matthew?
No, that's absolutely. I see the same trend in the spaces that I operate in. We've seen an uptick in small molecule manufacturing. Absolutely.
Fantastic. And so now, can we expect a rise in clinical trials in India?
Oh, yes, absolutely. So, I mean, unfortunately, I think the, you know, if you look at the history of clinical trials in India and the fact that India has such a large and diverse population, clinical trial activity in India has, you know, been historically low, and it's very low in comparison to the population that is there, right? So, therefore, there is a huge opportunity. The pandemic, of course, pushed industry players to adapt and address traditional trial challenges. And if you look at the Indian healthcare landscape, it has been witnessing a significant surge in the demand, which is reflective of a global trend towards evidence-based care. And this growing need also stems from the recognition that achieving a higher standard of healthcare outcomes necessitates not only access to innovative drugs, devices, and treatment protocols, but also the fact that there should be rigorous testing and evaluation of their efficacy and safety. In India, in fact, this necessity is further compounded by the country's diverse genetic pool, encompassing a multitude of ethnicities, lifestyles, and disease profiles. But this diversity also presents a unique opportunity to conduct comprehensive and inclusive clinical trials that can provide valuable insights into the effectiveness of medical interventions across various population groups. In addition, we believe that there's a robust pharmaceutical industry in India, coupled with its vast pool of highly skilled professionals who are proficient in English, it offers a very conducive environment for conducting trials. if you look at activity in clinical trials before 2014, I think it was fairly low, but with the regulatory changes which started from 2019 and the new drugs and clinical trials rules which came out in 2019, and all of these regulatory reforms were aimed towards global harmonization and enabling open access to clinical trials in India, we see a fair bit of uptick in clinical trials. In fact, the regulatory reforms have also kind of streamlined the approval processes, and that has resulted in reduced timelines by close to around 30 to 40%. And there are certain exemptions which have been provided within the clinical trial phase for certain categories. So all of this has kind of helped in, a larger industry playing a larger role on clinical trials and R&D. I mean, some of the top sponsors who come to my mind are the likes of the AstraZeneca, the Novartis, the Johnson & Johnsons, who have been kind of getting into clinical trials in India. I think there's also been successful partnerships between hospitals and other private companies. If I recollect correctly, it was Apollo and Sanofi, which created a program for providing integrated diabetes care programs in India. So there's a lot of activity which is happening in this space. And we believe that India presents both, there are challenges, but the opportunities and the positives in relation to clinical trials are far higher than the challenges. And we'll see that kind of increasing in time to come.
Yeah, and the regulatory regimes kind of kept pace with these developments. So it's easier to share clinical data. It's easier to verify clinical data. Approvals are coming quicker. Genome data, for example, can be transferred across the globe with approvals. So again, with technology, kind of evolving as well, the need to, need to create structures which don't involve intense regulatory approvals or long processes have also, come to be. And therefore, to a large extent, we see India having moved into a fairly, as of yet, a fairly active position in terms of clinical trials. And we see the number of clinical trials in the country increasing year on year, applications increasing year on year, approvals coming quicker. So all in all, again, we see this as something that the government's purposely worked on improving while keeping the protection of the population generally on priority as well.
Okay, and in terms of business deals, do you see increasing instances of international companies considering acquisitions of Indian firms?
Should I take that first?
Yes, sure, please go ahead.
So we see it at multiple levels, and it's a personal hobby of mine to chat this, which is why I jumped in very enthusiastically. The good news is, at the lowest end of the market, venture capital funded, what Praveen and I call nonsense enterprises, in that space, funding has dried up, and that's a great sign. What I mean by that is kind of disguised e-commerce plays on pharmaceuticals, wellness plays, the kind of I will cure cancer using yoga startups have all dried up. And that I think is a sign that both the venture capital industry or even the private equity industry are all maturing in their outlook towards India's wellness and life sciences space. Within the wellness space, we see large deals, like I said, in vitamin K12. We see some deals in peptides. We see a lot of deals in palliative care. So that's all interesting. In pharma, there have been deals. I don't know if there is a huge uptick. I think there is an uptick. It's more gradual than sudden, as opposed to the other spaces. But where there is a hitherto unexpected explosion of deals is in hospitals. We've seen very large investments. We've seen acquisitions. We've seen consolidations, some of which obviously with the recent Manipal deal have just provided a surplus in capital. And all of this goes along with two Other trends that we've seen, one is a rise of effective insurance products in the market. So, hey, hospitals are probably the first ones to benefit in that. And the second is a recognition that India's domestic market is actually fairly large by itself. So as opposed to a, I will invest and acquire companies that look at only export, we've seen a lot of focus on the domestic consumers in India as well. So exciting times to be a deal lawyer in this space. Praveen?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, even if you looked at 2023 as against 2022, I think the market saw a huge uptick in numbers, at least in the Indian life sciences space. We saw going, I mean, in some statistics over here, I think that in 2022, we had close to around $135 billion of deal activity, which happened in the life sciences space. By the end of October 2023, we were already at $163 billion. So, you know, there's been a huge jump there. But primarily, I mean, so that's where I think that statistically, at least, Matthew, I think that just, I think it's been driven by the pharmaceutical segment from a deal value perspective, because they're obviously much larger deal values. But I think that both in 2023, we've seen both an increase in M&A deal value as well as increase in deal volume. Obviously, pharmaceutical companies have remained somewhat insulated from the higher rates and, you know, higher rates of inflation and their ability to readily deploy capital because of free cash flows. If you look at 2024, we believe that, you know, there will be a continued activity. There will be continued activity in the M&A space, in the pharma space, in the life sciences and pharma space. And one is, I go back to the, the mention of the fact that we probably will be hitting a patent cliff somewhere during this, you know, the next few years. And that could lead for big pharma to plug portfolio gaps through M&A. And we believe that big pharma will continue to target late stage development companies and early stage commercial assets as well. We also see that there will be, and I think probably Matthew may add into this as well, which is, AI fits into and has kind of become an integral part not just of the life sciences sector, but I think across. So we are seeing a lot of life sciences companies also looking at integration through strategic M&As and through strategic collaborations for AI-driven capabilities, internal capabilities, which will be for both drug development or across this thing, not just drug development, but diagnosis, med tech, efficiencies in manufacturing and all of that, right? So that's something that we believe will happen over the course of 2024. Just one last bit on this was, we think that even we believe that there will be a fair bit of activity within medtech companies as well, in addition to the areas that Matthew mentioned. I think that we did see a little bit of a slowdown in 22-23 on medtech companies. There were a lot of divestitures, but I think in the they will be returning to growth M&A in the years to come.
I don't have statistics at the top of my head, but I suspect that some of the large M&A deals that you're seeing, and even the large private equity deals that you're seeing, are also looking to tap into that contract development and manufacturing space, particularly as global pharma follows their friends in other spaces and presumably deploys the China plus one kind of strategy across India and perhaps other jurisdictions. You could see India's role in and given what India proved, how useful India proved to be in the supply chain of, in the supply of COVID vaccines, I think you're seeing a lot of the manufacturing shifting. As the manufacturer shifts, you're seeing a lot of private equity follow that. So that's definitely happened. But this is a little bit of guesswork in terms of the impact on overall deal values and numbers. But I think that probably, I would take an educated guess that this process has led to an increase in valuations of Indian manufacturing companies.
And during these acquisitions, how do they navigate acquiring Indian intellectual property, manufacturing units or specific molecules?
I think a well set patterns. I don't think there's anything particular to life sciences in the acquisition of IP. Indian patent law raises a few procedural differences from global practices that you'll have to jump through. But as a deal lawyer, I don't think we've seen issues on IP arise. Where do we do see issues is kind of Indian classification is just around whether something's a drug and not a drug. So India's foreign exchange laws very clearly say that if you are manufacturing a drug, or if you're in the, if you're in the pharmaceutical sector, i.e., for the sake of simplicity, manufacturing a drug, you cannot, more than 76% of the shareholding of such companies cannot be held by foreigners at one go, right? So you'll need approval, etc. Now, given that you'll need approval, there's a little bit of regulatory lack of clarity around whether some products are drugs, or whether they're not drugs, or fall within those definitions, and therefore whether they fall within the restrictions of within that 76% restriction of ownership transfer. We've seen a couple of deals flounder on that. We've never seen deals flounder on IP. We'd like to think that the pharma industry in India, the general life sciences industry in India, is one which takes its intellectual property fairly seriously. Even if they do take calculated risks on IP, it's fairly evolved, sophisticated systems that are used around that manufacturing process, the generics process, the patenting around a patent process. So all of that is fairly well out. We've not seen an impact on deals. Praveen, have you at your end of the woods, have you seen any impact on the IP systems adopted by the domestic market in cross-border deals?
No, actually not at all, because I think that, like you rightly said, I think that when it comes to IP and protection of IP and, you know, all of the checks and balances that need to be there for IP protection, I think Indian large pharma in India has, you know, are sophisticated enough to kind of ensure that they are well protected, and therefore we don't see any problems with IP. I think we see maybe not so much with large pharma, but maybe, you know, probably one level below that, where you have fairly big pharmaceutical companies, but not global brands, but they're probably manufacturing, you know, generics at APIs at probably a smaller scale. We do see a lot of compliance hurdles that we have to go through, or governance related aspects. I think those are things that we kind of come across, but I've not come across any situations where we believe that, or we've seen any situations where deals have not gone through because of, you know, these aspects, right? I think that we've always, even if there have been hiccups, there have been very small hiccups in relation to these aspects, which, you know, there are we find methods and ways within the transaction structure to kind of surpass.
And regarding the integration of artificial intelligence in this industry, do you see any progress, or has it only been a theory or point of discussion?
There's obviously been a lot of noise. We've seen a fair amount of action in terms of deployment, particularly in diagnosis, because what artificial intelligence, or let's take a step back and not call it AI, but call it deep learning or machine learning. What that gives in terms of capability is the ability to scrunch large parts of data and identify patterns. And that's across all industries. So obviously, we have the ability now, AI, ML, deep learning have the ability to clearly impact diagnosis. So we've got multiple large businesses built on not necessarily just in the domestic space, but also large Indian companies servicing hospitals across the globe, which provide suggestive diagnosis. So the laws of most countries say that machines cannot diagnose, but it'll be in conjunction or a suggestion to a registered medical professional. But we've had artificial intelligence being used to kind of power quicker diagnosis, quicker suggestion to doctors, who then are able to check and verify the diagnosis again and say, hey, I agree with this or I don't. Is there a risk for liability issues arising? Absolutely. Grappling with multiple clients or trying to assess liability, how to mitigate it, what kind of protection insurance offers, all of that. The other sector where AI is being deployed, although success rates are yet to be seen, is in drug design and discovery. We've seen that being deployed. We've not seen the results of that deployment yet in the market. So we'll see how efficient it is in the next 3 to 4 years. But rest assured that all of India's big pharma are grappling with AI, different kinds of applications depending on the sector that they focus on. And I think, yes, that's going to keep becoming larger and larger and bigger part of at least what Praveen and I do with our pharma and life sciences clients.
Anything additional, Praveen?
No, I think Matthew has covered. I mean, when it comes to AI, I think Matthew covers most of the points.
Okay, great. And how do you think the new Indian data law will impact the industry?
So the new Indian data law does not have a health-specific chapter. So to a large extent, it's a general data law which says, to summarize a large statute, which says you must take consent for any use of personalized information. That's it. A simple answer to a complicated question. What that probably means is that large amounts of health data issues are left unanswered by the Indian law. We don't have a HIPAA-specific legislative proposal at this stage. I wish we did. I think the government is aware of this. I do think that we will either see subsidiary rules under India's new data law that addresses HIPAA-like concerns in India. Alternatively, we may see a new law focused only on health data. Slightly unlikely, but I would imagine it's top of priority for the government, particularly since there is, for the domestic market, a move to introduce a national health card, which provides all your health details at one go, and which therefore raises big concerns around misuse, etc. Exciting times to be a health data, health tech focused lawyer in India. Do I have a solve? Does it look comprehensive? It doesn't. Are the government regulators closely watching the space and coming out with drafts? Yes, they are. Some of the drafts are already public, but I don't think we've got even 1/10 of the puzzle. So that'll be work in progress from a regulatory perspective. Right now, there are very few, other than consent, of course, there are very few restrictions on enterprises' ability to use, process, store, and transfer data.
Right, and I think this is also something that we kind of come across when it comes to M&A transactions. I think there's a lot more attention over here, but like Matthew said, I think that the regulatory regime is still far from anywhere close to a HIPAA or anything in a sophisticated jurisdiction. So
I think the word that most M&A lawyers would use is that the regulatory regime is permissive at this point, quote unquote. But yeah.
And you touched on this slightly, but does it align with the HIPAA, the Health Insurance Portability and Accountability Act?
Absolutely not. So the HIPAA is a different, very sophisticated engine on the use of information and data within the health space. It creates checks and balances across the multiple companies that use, collect, and process data. Indian law does nothing of that sort. Not even the new Indian law does that. In fact, there was a proposal to introduce some kind of a legislation that governs health data used by hospitals. For good or for bad, that's not, I don't think that's going to be implemented. I'm kind of hoping that the new data protection board will have health data at the top of its priority. Guidance would be guidance from the central government, sophisticated guidance from the central government on how to deal with, you know, the nuances of the modern evolving life sciences and healthcare space would be useful. It's much needed. There is much need for propriety in that space in India at this point.
And do you think that India offers sufficient protection to pharmaceutical products? Is there a need for a shift in this framework as Indian companies get more aggressive with the new products?
Yeah, so again, let's take a little bit of a historic look at India's IP protection regimes. The 1970 Patent Act was designed to encourage the generic industry. And when designed to encourage the generic industry, that means there was a healthy disregard for global IP. If you look at the last 20 years, you will see multiple decisions that and legislative and regulatory changes that rolls back this general policy. So do we have a much more robust protection of intellectual property in the pharma and life sciences space? Yes, we do. Are there gaps that need to be and technical gaps that need to be filled, for example, in the definition of innovation, how regulators and courts and IP offices look at drug developments? Yes, there, and look at evergreening, for example. Yes, there is a need for all of that. But to paraphrase or to copy an old tagline from a very famous company, it's getting better all the time, right? And yes, you can see domestic pharma, along with regulatory changes, slowly increasing its focus on development of new products. And obviously, because once you get patent protection, there's sufficient incentive to kind of, you know, spend the money required to develop new products. Still work in progress, but again, I think in the next 5 to 10 years, you will see the results of all these legislative, regulatory, and judicial changes. What it has meant is that large firms like ours, who focus on, I shouldn't say large firms because we're not a large firm, but larger pharma practices like ours, which focus primarily on commercial IP and on deals in the space, also have a large enough patent practice now focused on providing services to not just our global clients, but also to our domestic pharma clients.
So how are medical devices currently regulated, and are there anticipated changes in this domain?
Raju, do you want to take this, and I'll take the software as a medical device?
Yeah, sure. So, I mean, if you look at medical devices, until 2017, there were no specific regulations, and, you know, specifically for devices, and devices were regulated under the definition of drugs under the Drugs and Cosmetics Act. The 2017 medical devices rules are the new regulations for medical devices. And they're largely keeping in pace with the requirements. They were also amended in 2020. These rules cover various aspects of device-related regulations, including classification, registration, manufacture and import, post-market requirements, all of that. The rules are, of course, a very positive step and encompass most of most of the processes which are contained in the European Union approval processes. And the mandate is basically to make sure that devices are safe and performs to its intended function. The definition itself of devices is widely defined. It includes pretty much everything. In vitro diagnostics, surgical dressings, ligatures, blood and blood component collection bags, mechanical contraceptives and various other devices which are notified by the, you know, under the Drugs Act. Similar to drugs and the approval process for drugs, there is the requirement of a clinical investigation of the investigational medical device on human participants to assess its safety, performance, and effectiveness. Clinical investigation or clinical performance evaluations are performed based on the clinical investigation plans, etc., which are prescribed under the rules. Additionally, within the rules itself, they have brought in the need for the rights, safety, and well-being of the subjects who should be protected, consistent with ethical principles as per international protocols. In addition to all of that, there's also the requirement for medical standard, medical devices to conform with what is known as the BIS or the Bureau of Indian Standards, which is established under the Bureau of Indian Standards Act 1985. Where there is no relevant standard for a particular device, it has to comply with the IEC or the International Organization for Standardization or the IEC, the ISO or the IEC. There's also the latest move was in 2023, where the Union Cabinet also approved what is called as the National Medical Devices Policy 2023. The policy is largely with an intent to adopt a patient-centric approach, emphasizing on quality, safety, and efficacy of medical devices. It also is to ensure that there is a reduction in dependence on India's import reliance for medical devices. And I think that's the primary reason behind the medical devices policy. It's very closely tied in with what is called as the Make in India initiative. If you look at the current market, the bulk of medical devices in India are imported. And this policy is largely aimed at creating self-reliance and resilience and competitiveness within the market itself. So I think that's the overall regulatory framework for medical devices in India. In addition, the government also has come out with various what is called as production link incentive schemes for setting up manufacturing plants in India. And that's not only in the medical devices space, but there is various PLIs which have come out in multiple multiple subsectors of the life sciences space.
Yeah, so just to jump in here, well, Praveen is the guru, at least at our firm, on medical devices. I look at a strange edge case, which is software as a medical device. Without going into too much of nuance, two conclusions. Firstly, software itself can be classified as a medical device. And secondly, if you look at the legislative history of the new medical devices rules, you will see that there's enough there to indicate that while the rules are still slightly vague, that all interpretation of the rules will be consistent with the IMDRF global standards, and therefore it makes it easier for global medical devices companies to comply with Indian regulations. Still needs approval, still will take time, but it is consistent with global practices.
Now moving forward, where do you see the trajectory of the industry going? What does the future hold for the life sciences industry within India?
So let me just quickly give my two bits about this, and then Matthew, you can pitch in. Of course, like I mentioned, generics has been the largest market for the Indian pharmaceutical industry in India, right? But what we see as a trend, and I kind of touched upon this earlier as well, which is with US, which is India's largest pharma market, witnessing a significant drop in generic drug prices and increased competition, distributor consolidation and government push, I think that the heat is felt by the Indian pharmaceutical industry as well. At a global level, all of this is affecting the revenues of India's pharma companies
who are purely concentrating on generics. Therefore, we see a shift in the approach to more innovative and novel drugs and vaccines. The other trajectory that we see the pharmaceutical industry going in is biosimilars, which I touched upon very briefly in the beginning. We already, Indian pharmaceutical companies have a significant share of the global biosimilars market. India is already has already approved you know, close to around 100 biosimilars with another 40 plus in clinical stages. The country itself offers an advantage in terms of lower cost for research and development, and this is effectively increased development of biosimilars in the country, coupled with, of course, the whole patent cliff, which is there. We believe that this is going to be another path that a lot of the Indian pharmaceutical companies will kind of go down to kind of see, and you know, and that's going to be one of the strong trajectory growths for the Indian pharmaceutical industry. The third that we see is that, you know, novel drugs, which are effectively undergoing clinical development that have not been approved by the US FDA. They're classified effectively into two, either as new chemical entities or new biological entities. These products have also been receiving significant attention from leading multinational pharma players, and it is inevitable that the Indian pharma sector also leverage its expertise in chemistry and biologics to make sure that their future is secured and sustainable by going into novel drugs as well. Then there is, of course, the biologics market, which is, you know, today the market, Indian market, is primarily dominated by simple biologics such as insulin or drugs for cardiovascular and autoimmune diseases. So they have a certain advantage with the ability of less likelihood, I mean, less likelihood of adverse side effects. And it is also associated with small molecule therapeutics. And we believe that this is another space that we will see a lot of the Indian pharma companies kind of looking at in the years to come. Of course, other than that, I think that there is AI, there's medical devices, et cetera. So we do see a fair bit of activity in that space as well.
Yeah, from my perspective, I think we're going to see a huge number of deals in hospitals, hospital chains. I think we will see consolidation across the domestic market. And I think we will see international private equity as well as strategic players enter the space. Obviously, as the domestic market deepens and the ability of Indian consumers to spend more increases, I think we're going to see an increase in medical tourism, and consistent with that, an increase in deal activity in that space. I think we will see some shout outs from wellness and palliative care. It may not be consistent. There may not be a flood of deals, but I think the few deals that will emerge would be fairly large. I think you will see a lot of deals in novel technologies. For example, we have a client who allows you to scrub into surgeries from remote locations. Right? I have a client who allows you who has a mobile a diagnosis van that's going to, you know, go around and diagnose diseases. Let's look at people who look at predictive, disease prediction methods and algorithms. I think we'll see an increase in robotic implements in surgery. And within the pharma space itself, I think you'll see two trends. One is you will see Indian companies moving up the value chain, perhaps over the next 5 to 10 years into final products. So that's one huge change. You will also see integration, closer integration between global pharma companies and Indian pharma companies. Perhaps you'll see large acquisitions. So all in all, deal activity, which is already skyrocketed. And if I remember statistics right again, I think eclipsed most of Asia in terms of deal activity in the last 2 years in this space. I think you're going to see it increase consistently year on year. I wouldn't want to hazard, you know, where within the Asian rankings it would end up being, but I think we expect frenetic activity in the deal space across all sectors. We also expect frenetic product and technology development, and specialized product and technology development. So we'll probably see, as opposed to 5 large pharma companies or 15 large pharma companies, you would probably see 150 fairly large pharma companies. I suspect it's already started happening. I suspect we'll also see large Indian domestic conglomerates suddenly look to enter various parts of the pharma space, right? Those are a little less adventurous, will probably look at wellness, but I don't see any of the 5-6 large Indian industrial houses staying away from investments in this. We've already seen investments from some of the largest ones into labs, into hospitals, into pharma companies, not as extensive into pharma companies, but into labs, into hospitals, into R&D, into genome sequencing, into medical devices. We'd see that expanding to everything. We'd also then end up seeing vertical and horizontal integrations in the market. So all in all, for us lawyers, that we expect this to be most exciting.
Fantastic. Thank you, Matthew. Thank you, Praveen. We now have a couple of questions coming from today's audience. The first of which is, most Indian pharma companies are reporting reduced or flat revenues. So where is this growth coming from?
I'm not sure where that statistic is coming from, because I would believe that, you know, pharma companies, and if we were to look at pharma companies and their growth, there has been a steady growth in revenues, and especially, I mean, if we look at the years since 2020 onwards, there was probably a short while in 2019 when there was a dip in pharma revenues, but otherwise, I believe that pharma revenues have steadily grown. Even if you look at the market in India, there has been a steady growth of close to around 11% domestically. And 16% when it comes to exports. And that's been steady over the last decade or so. So I kind of not sure where that data is coming from. But I would think that, again, if it is, you know, what are the factors which lead to this, you know, the pharma company's growth? I think it's largely, again, I think there's a huge portion of this, which is the generics market, and that continues to grow. While we say that it's, you know, there needs to be a change there, and we will see a change over there, that's a, you know, continues to be a large market, and we will continue to see a large part of the revenue in the pharma sector coming out of that. Again, the other big play has been vaccines, and India has become one of the largest vaccine manufacturers and suppliers globally. So therefore, that also is a big play. Like I said earlier, I think that there are other areas that Indian pharma companies are entering into, but I think they're probably early stages and they may not necessarily actually contribute at this point of time to any kind of revenue. If I were to look at other life sciences companies other than pharma, be it medical devices or all of the others which are there, I would believe that, you know, they are, you know, they're not, they're small in comparison to the pharma companies and the size of revenues of the pharma companies in India today. But we see that growing as well. So we'll see medical devices, we will see AI, we will see, you know, more biotechnology, we will see a lot of activity happening in that space as well.
I think in that space, there's a lot of churn, right? I think you'll see increased churn in the market. So if you follow 5 traditional pharma plays in India, you'll probably see muted growth. And I wouldn't hazard, you know, a guess as to what each of these growth would be, but you'd probably see muted growth, regular growth, because they are large, sophisticated companies growing regularly at percentages in which large, sophisticated companies grow at. However, what you will see is that this growth is despite niche players eating into certain parts of their profits. and their revenues. And so they've ceded ground on some of the larger space that they've occupied for equally profitable, slightly smaller and medium companies that are growing fairly quickly. So like I said, if you were to assume that there'd be 15 companies that constitute big pharma in India or life sciences companies above a certain threshold in India. And if you were to say that there are 150 companies, that there will be 150 companies in 10 years. However, if you track only the revenues of those 15 companies, you'd probably still see 10% growth, 15% growth, 20% growth, in some cases 2%, 3%. But this is not a function of the market becoming smaller, it's a function of hyper competition and other newer, more aggressive players seizing the market. It's the same phenomena we see in multiple other industries. It's just playing out in Indian pharma for the first time, and it's playing out at a pace which we haven't seen before. A good example to look at is the revenues of clinical trial companies in India over the last 3 years, right? You've seen a huge increase. If you look at hospitals over the last 3 years, you'll see a huge increase. If you only track four generic drug manufacturers, you may not see that huge an increase. So it depends on how you define the market. But the market's definitely getting larger.
Okay, and our next question from today's audience: how do Indian smartwatch manufacturers compare to the US, Korean, Japanese, and Chinese competitors, a health sensor and app-wise?
It seems to be a consumer question, but as someone who consumes smartwatches, and the space at which I lose to every month, I've gone through all of them. I do think that large American and European smartwatch manufacturers have a slight technological lead in terms of how they're positioned within the market. They're very expensive, of course. There are cheaper alternatives that flooded in the market, both Indian alternatives as well as alternatives from other countries in Asia. I think there's a place in the market for everyone. I have my favorites. That disagrees with Praveen. I think for what I use it for, I like my Fitbit. I think for what Praveen uses his for, I think he prefers Garmin and Whoop and multiple of those very slightly more specialized smartwatches. But there are much, much cheaper alternatives as well. And I can see first-time consumers buying much, much cheaper alternatives, including self-branded smaller companies or now in only one state in India, but where they have a large presence in the smartwatch space. Interesting market. The regulations are clear. Okay, the regulations are kind of clear. Some of the gray areas are often on the complexities smartwatches and data sharing and data collection give up to are sometimes ignored by the domestic market. So all in all, a space to watch out for in terms of regulatory action, government crackdown, and perhaps consolidation. Praveen, do you want to add in? I kind of spoke for you, but we've had multiple.
That's fine. I think that I would think that, I think while the majority of the market is filled by products from which are imported, right? I think there are a large number of products in India, but I'm not sure whether they match up to the level of advanced fitness tracking features or features that some of the others do provide. Maybe that will change in time, but that's how I see the Indian market when it comes to smartwatches specifically.
Okay, thank you. And Matthew, I agree. I'm a big fan of my Fitbit as well. And I'm afraid that that's all we have time for today. So I'd like to thank our fantastic panel, Matthew and Praveen, for what has been an incredibly insightful event today. And of course, thank you to our audience for your participation. I encourage those with additional questions surrounding today's topics to reach out to our experts directly. And we hope to see you all again soon.
Thank you, Charlie. Thank you. Thank you very much. And thank you, everyone.
Thank you.